Friday. And we all, yeah, we're on. I was in the stratosphere for a little while. Maybe the thermosphere. I think I hit the thermosphere there for a minute. Hey, everybody. How's it going? Carrie's in the house, so watch your P's and Q's. All you sex bots will be bounced tonight. Oh, yeah. So, I'll be reading the chat. Everyone's checking in. A lot of news this week. Some of it sad. It's always sad news when you get into my age that, you know, all the heroes, it's just like every week, it's just a procession of heroes just nodding off and, you know, conking out. It's just, it's kind of like what being my age is all about, is every week it's a new list of heroes that goes away. And I want to talk about that in a moment. Thermosphere, yes. Above the stratosphere. The extremely rarefied atmosphere. This week it was all over the in many papers. J.I. Allison, drummer for the Crickets, the last surviving member of the Crickets to pass, 82. It's really weird. I'm not going to say ironic. Well, I guess it is colloquially ironic, although that's not really what irony is about, that by strange coincidence, I was thinking about J.I. Allison earlier in the week. The obituaries, which were all wrong about the, like, all the obits that I read this week that were printed about J.I. Allison that listed, like, the history of the Crickets, they all got it wrong. It's like they're all, like, just going to Wikipedia or Googling and everything. They all got it wrong, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But, you know, J.I. was, he was not only the drummer of the Crickets, but he was, like, the he co-wrote Peggy Sue and co-wrote a lot of the hits, and he was integral to the Cricket sound. His sort of, he always played a small, condensed, you know, tight kit. And he often would go off the, he didn't use drums, like in Not Fade Away, he just played the top of a cardboard box. And other ones, every day he just played his thighs. He just slapped the top of his jeans to play that as Vi Petty played the Celeste in the background. Not Norman Petty, Vi Petty played the Celeste, thank you very much. But I was thinking about J.I. Allison early in the weekend, so I put it in my list of things to watch to pull out the real Buddy Holly story. Not that movie that you're gonna think of, that Gary Busey movie. If you've never seen it, do me a favor, do humanity a favor, and never ever watch that Gary Busey film about Buddy Holly, because that film is a complete travesty. Quite literally nothing in that film, short of the fact that Buddy Holly dies at the end, nothing in that film ever happened. It is so sad. Maria Elena Holly kind of signed off on the film deal and gave them just a blank check to do whatever they wanted, and it just made up a complete fantasy. Nothing in that film ever happened. And the list of events is just so, no. But I was watching this film, the real film, the Buddy Holly, the real Buddy Holly story. This is the film that was, oh, come on, focus. You can focus, there you go. This is the Paul McCartney film. He produced this in conjunction with the BBC and a couple other partners. Forget the guy who actually directed it. I mean, Paul McCartney produced it. Paul McCartney hosts it. He's interviewed in it. But this is, if you want to watch a film that's about Buddy Holly, the Crickets, J.I. Allison, and J.B. Muldoon, and all the characters, Sonny Curtis, and all of them, this is the one to watch. It's the hour and a half that's worth your time. The real Buddy Holly story by Paul McCartney, Sir Paul. But I was watching this Tuesday night. It was like the first time. I have it on Laserdisc too. Although the Laserdisc version is slightly different, because the Laserdisc version I have is an MPL release. That's MPL was Paul McCartney and Linda McCartney's film production company, and it was the MPL release is slightly different. There was a couple things in this version that were, I think, added a little later for the DVD release, because this was actually produced by an American company. It's not Paul McCartney did the DVD release. So I guess he either sold the project or the BBC licensed the rights to publish this, because, but anyway, my original Laserdisc is an MPL release. Highly recommend it, but yeah, the obits totally got the history of the crickets wrong. But yeah, boy, it's a big loss. Last of the last. Paul McCartney is kind of elemental to the whole story because he, you know, other than being like a huge crickets fan, that's kind of an understatement. I mean, there would be no Beatles without the crickets. And when the crickets played in the UK on their only tour of the UK, Lennon and McCartney were both there watching the show that he played. And McCartney produced the crickets. There was a record. The record came out. This one. This one. This was from. How was this? 88. Okay. T-shirt. Come on. T-shirt. But this is the record, the Crickets record that Paul McCartney produced, and he actually plays on this and sings on it a little bit. But this is when Gordon Payne was heading the Crickets. But after Buddy Holly died, Sonny Curtis, who was the original lead guitar player for the Crickets, not Nicky Sullivan, as it's on many internet sites, say, oh, Nicky Sullivan, original. No, Nicky Sullivan was not the original lead guitar player to the Crickets. It was Sonny Curtis. Because if you back one history, back to 1955, when, was it 55, when Elvis was on his first tour, he played his first live show in the Lubbock area, and Buddy Holly and Sonny Curtis and the other members of the Crickets, they were pretty much still in high school, went and saw Elvis. And previous to that, in 54, Buddy Holly was in a band with Bob Montgomery, and they had a bluegrass group called Buddy and Bob, which was very good. And those recordings exist. They you know, after Buddy Holly died, the Buddy and Bob recordings got released, I think, by Norman Petty, probably. but if you go on either YouTube or somewhere, you're going to find the Buddy and Bob recordings. I urge you to listen to them. If you listen to those recordings and think these kids are 16 years old, man, it's like, damn. When after Buddy Holly graduated, it was after 55, when because they had a manager and everything. High Pockets Duncan was their manager, this DJ, this kind of old grizzly guy, and it was based on the Buddy and Bob stuff that after Elvis came through, they all decided, oh, we're off bluegrass, we're done now. Elvis came through with it was Johnny Cash and Carl Perkins, and Elvis were on this dime tour and playing some gymnasium, and all the guys who were part of the Crickets legacy, it was just like when Buddy Holly played in the UK, that all the people that were there, who will later become like big 60s British bands, was like, you know, everything changed. And so when Elvis came through, they said, no, we're off bluegrass, we're all gonna do rock and roll. And like the following year, 56, they were doing tile work for Buddy Holly's dad, who had a tiling company. And so Buddy and his two brothers would work with his dad and doing tiling work, and they would take the money that they earned doing tiling work and pay for recording sessions to record their stuff. And they were doing that with Buddy and Bob, and then later, based on that stuff, they got a recording contract to do some records for Decca in Nashville, and Buddy Holly hated it because they wanted him to do country, and didn't want to do country, they didn't want to do bluegrass, they wanted to do rock, but they wouldn't let him play rock and roll, and they wouldn't let him use drums. So but Sonny Curtis was in there, and J.I., and JP Muldoon didn't come in until 57, but it was 56. Sonny Curtis, he left because he was now out of high school and wanted to actually earn money, and he didn't want to do tiling anymore. So Sonny Curtis left the Crickets to join Slim Whitman's band and went on tour like right away, and missed the boat because it wasn't until the following year that the Crickets did their first tours and got on the Ed Sullivan Show, and they took Nikki Sullivan with them. And Nikki Sullivan is usually, you know, credited as being the first guitar player, but Nikki Sullivan was not the lead guitar player, he was the rhythm guitar player, because by 57, Buddy Holly was doing the leads, but it was Sonny Curtis who did the leads on the original recordings. And then after, Buddy Holly left the Crickets because Norman Petty was holding a steel hammer over him, and he wanted to break free because he wasn't earning any money. And the only reason that Buddy Holly went on tour and died on tour in the Winter Dance Party was because Norman Petty wouldn't pay him any royalties for the songs that they had done, because they were in dispute. He wanted out of the contract, say, because he was now living in New York, he was now married, and he wanted to be a big producer, and Norman Petty would not release him from the contract. So he went out on the tour by himself just to pay the rent and died on tour. But after he died, the Crickets stayed together as a group with J.I. and Joe B., and Bobby V. played, like, he led the Crickets for a while, which was really creepy because it was a little too on the nose, because Bobby V. was actually, he was like a Buddy Holly impersonator, practically, vocally, and so they really, and I was looking for my Bobby V. and the Crickets record, which I have in there, but I couldn't find it. My LPs have been shuffled several times the last few years with the move and boxes, so I for whatever reason it's not with the Cricket stuff, it's randomly somewhere in there. But yeah, but then Sonny Curtis came back in the 60s, and several other times there were numerous times Sonny Curtis came back to lead the Crickets. But Sonny Curtis, then, you know, he's a very famous singer songwriter he wrote I Fought the Law. That, you know, Bobby Fuller got the hit with it, but he wrote it. And he wrote other, like, country crossover hits with J.I. Allison and such. But he's most famously known, everyone knows the song that he wrote, the theme to the Mary Tyler Moore Show, Love Is All Around Us, which, So, yeah. But, yeah, like, many, many, many decades of history with Sonny Curtis being in and out of the Crickets. Joe B. died some time ago. He died in the, I think he died in the 90s, but he was like the first. But J.I., he kept going, still active. They did some reunion tours with J.I. and Sonny Curtis. I think in the aughts, the Crickets were touring and stuff. But yeah, it's Joe B. The last of the real good old boy crossover rockers is, I mean, to know the real history of that period of time in American music is really to know about, like, American music at the time. The crossover between the country acts and you know, we're talking the age of segregation in America, you know, before the Civil Rights era, and the musical crossover between black acts and like these southern white acts. Like, they would go out on tour, and on the tour bus it was like, you know, 2020. It's just a fascinating world to look into. You know, it's like when you look at, like, the music, and particularly the bands and what's happening in the bands and the mixture of musicians, you're looking at the future of America and the future of American culture decades before it would happen. The merging of musical styles, the influences, the respect between people, and it's just a fascinating time and a fascinating group of people who were way ahead of their time in lots of ways. Sad. And yeah, Sonny Curtis's song about, I think it's called The Real Buddy Holly Story, but the song that he plays in that film, that Paul McCartney film, where he, like, basically, like, wraps up like the whole history of everything they did, like in one song, kind of like a Dewey Cox style, you know, like the sum of the entire story in just one song. But yeah, it's just so weird, because it said in the paper that they announced that J.I. had died on Wednesday, so I'm assuming Tuesday, when I was watching the movie, I'm assuming that he was still alive, or maybe, man, but yeah, just very, I was thinking about him. Yeah, end of an era, and I've been saying it for years to myself that when Paul McCartney dies, it's pretty much going to be like the end for me. It's going to be the end of my childhood heroes. Like, you know, please stay alive, Paul McCartney. please stay alive for another decade, please. You don't even have to keep recording. You just please don't die. That's all I'm asking. Is it too much to ask for Paul McCartney to get close to being 100? Is it too much to ask of the universe? I mean, you had to take Prince and Bowie. Can we keep Paul McCartney just a little bit longer, please? Okay. Sad news. Goodbye, Jay. Yeah, it's just, well. Anyway. How long is it by? How long was I off there? Can I backwind that? When did I start talking? I didn't talk for 20 minutes about that, did I? Did I talk for 20 minutes on that? Oh, jeez. Oh my God. I'm backwinding the chat. It's like, oh my God, look at all this. I've been talking for freaking 20 minutes. Looking at my analytics, it looks like everybody signed off in the middle of my rant there. That's funny. No Ringo Starr, though? Well, no, I love Ringo, but, you know, I gotta pick and choose, you know? Now, Paul McCartney, he represents, yes, there's lots of people there, dozens of people on my heroes list who are not yet dead. Carole King being one of them, who's now 80. Who I read an op-ed in the Times just today from Carole King, you know, 80 years old, still kicking and going. So I'm just, yeah, but man, yeah, Paul McCartney is sort of like the benchmark by which my generation of heroes will be like teetered. It's like, yes, Pete Townsend is still alive. Yes. It's like, you could use Pete Townsend as the anchor point. Well, what about Roger Daltrey? Okay. It's like, everyone's got their heroes. Yes, the Stones are still around. Nobody could have foreseen that. That Keith Richards would still be alive today. How did that happen? Oh. Ringo is the voice of Thomas the Tank Engine. No, he's Mr. Conductor, is he not? Is he not Mr. Conductor on that show? Thomas the Tank Engine doesn't talk, I don't believe, does it? Does Thomas the Tank Engine talk? I don't know. It's Mr. Conductor, I believe. Anyway, yeah, everyone's got their heroes, but, you know. Also, another obituary and movie, Wolfgang Petersen also died this past week. And so on Monday, I watched Das Boot. Auf Deutsch, natürlich, but Wolfgang Petersen, who, you know, is more famous for his American films. He had a slew of hits in Hollywood, but, you know, Das Boot, still up there. But yeah, am I gonna spend my weeks watching movies and listening to records because someone on my heroes list is again died? Wolfgang. Okay. So, The Never Ending Story. Yes, he did. He did make The Never Ending Story. which I read in the obit. I think the Times theater critic had panned the Neverending Story, saying that it was a laughless like it's like I forget exactly how I said it, but it was basically saying I was like a humorless, laughless, dismal. It's like, man, it's a children's story made by a German. Yes, it's like welcome to a different culture. Yeah. yes. Das Boot is great, yes. Tool. Oh, there was a glitch in the middle of the Buddy Holly rant. Maybe that's why it dropped out. Maybe because let me check the stream elf here. The stream is healthy. Well, it'll be in the, maybe, you know, I might take that out as a, I'll probably post that separately as its own thing later. So maybe because the stream, I broadcast in 1080p at 30 frames, but it doesn't actually end up that way. YouTube doesn't broadcast me at 1080p at 30 frames. It's like, I get like 720, 15 frames if I'm lucky on the actual cast. So I do make a 1080p, like 1080, 60p recording here, which that's why I post like the higher resolution, like glitch free stuff later on in the week if there's something to, which that was the interesting thing this past week. I put that mega rant I did at the end of last week's cast, when I was like tired and just kind of went off on a tangent, I put that whole 22 minute rant up on its own, and my God, people were losing their cookies on that one, on the standalone. It's jeez, it's like so many, I can't even go there. What hardware and software use the stream? Well, I'm using Minicam. I got married into Minicam years ago. The encoder's fine. I mean, I'm actually running like a solid 1080p 30 frames here on this end. It's just that if you look at the actual stream, because whenever I do one of these, YouTube says, your stream warning, and it says right here, your stream's current bit rate of 1307 kilobits a second is lower than the recommended bit rate. It's like, well, it's whatever the bottleneck allows me. It's like, yeah, I run it wide open, but I live in Philadelphia, and this is actually the best it's been, because when I originally started trying to stream in the 1.0 lab, but I couldn't get enough bandwidth at that location. That was two labs ago, and you know, some time ago. But Philadelphia is so backward with bandwidth. And back in, you know, the 1.0, we're talking 6-7 years ago, I've tried many times to do live streaming, and the bandwidth just wasn't there even for the sync to work. And I would get dropped by YouTube. So, yeah, I mean, this is the best it's been bandwidth-wise. And I'm going to be putting it to the limit on Monday because... I don't know if Dave Jones has talked about it, but we've agreed to do a very experimental dual webcast on Monday morning, early for me, late for him, for the Artemis 1 launch. We've been debating back and forth about whether to do it, because I was contending, leading up to the launch, I was contending, well, it's probably like a 1 in 4 chance that they'll actually launch, they'll probably scrub. But I saw the briefing today, I watched the live cast of NASA and listened to the briefing, and they seem very confident. They're pretty much on top of everything, and the full up test they did and everything, they don't see any issues. So the only possible issue is weather. So if the weather like stays clear and they don't like stays within like the board limits, then they're probably going to launch the thing on Monday. So Dave and I are going to try this totally experimental thing. We have never tried it before. We're going to try a double live stream, if that's even possible. But I have complete confidence in Dave's ability to do it, but on my end, it means that I have to run two of my supercomputers at the same time through the same bottleneck to run two streams on two different channels. So I'll find out on Monday if I've got the bandwidth to do it, but I won't know until we try to do it live. So if the whole thing crashes and burns, it'll be not Artemis, but if the stream crashes and burns, it'll be because of the bandwidth bottleneck that we have here in Philly. But you know, I'm confident enough to give it a try. We'll see if it works. That's gonna be early Monday morning. Like, I think we're gonna start to 8 a.m. Eastern time, U.S. I don't know what that translates into your time, but it's gonna be like late at night for Dave and early in the morning for me. Yes, Maurice says weather's 70% go. I saw that today too. The forecast is 70% go, but as with all weather in the continental United States, particularly the eastern seaboard, 3 days away, 2 days away, you got no idea what the weather's going to be. So I'll be watching it, you know, closely Monday morning. But we're gonna try to get it all running at 8 a.m. Monday Eastern time. So hopefully over the weekend I'll get the nuts and bolts of that worked out, because I got to have two separate systems running, and they're gonna have to be synced up on two different streams. Boy, there's a lot of things could go wrong. A lot of things can go wrong. Artemis looks like a remodeled shuttle lift system. It is. In fact, all of the engines that are going to be running on Artemis have been flown on the shuttle. The four main engines have all been previously flown on shuttle flights. And the solid rocket boosters are the same Morton Thiokol type that were using the shuttle, and several sections, because they're five sections high. The Artemis are five sections high. The shuttle was four sections high. But those tube sections, those Morton Thiokol tube sections, they're all modular. And several of those sections that are on Artemis 1 did fly in shuttle flights. So yes, it's basically, you know, a mega shuttle. Although they did say many times in the recent sort of Q&A sessions that the center tank, although it looks just like the fuel tank in the shuttle, it's actually like got nothing, like it's like the only thing that makes it like the shuttle fuel tank is it's coated in the same kind of orange foam, but interior wise it's like a complete like ground up new thing, because it's bearing the weight, that center fuel tank, it's bearing the weight of the whole rocket. It's not like the shuttle fuel tank that was just kind of hanging off the side. It's like the fuel tank, it's like it's bearing the whole, all the fuel and the weight of the rocket. And as they pointed out in today's webcast, that, you know, without the solid rocket boosters, Artemis would not even leave the pad, because the main engines do not produce enough thrust to overcome the initial starting weight of the whole tank. The tank, there's so much, there's like a 100,000, like there's, yeah, there's more weight in fuel and oxidizer at launch than the main engines can produce in thrust. So without the solid rocket boosters, it would not take off, which I thought was fascinating. But they did say today in the press conference that they have contingencies for Artemis, even with two full flame outs on main engines, that they can still get to orbit on it. They said depending on the scenarios of when engines would conk out, but they can, in certain scenarios, lose up to two engines in the main engines and still get to orbit by continuing to do like a long burn. I mean, they really worked this out end to end. I mean, I was watching the 2-hour press conference today, and it's just like they thought of every possible scenario of how it could go wrong. So they're really, really on top of this. And like one of their engineers said, they said that, you know, in the blockhouses and stuff, doing all the preps and all the you know, rehearsals and everything for launch, he said it's getting very, very real. Everybody feels it. It's getting very, he said it many times, it's getting very real. So, I'm pumped. It would be cool if I streamed some Kerbal Space Program. I don't have any of the Kerbal software. Scott Manley does that. A lot of other people do that, but I don't have the time. Where would I get the time to do Kerbal? People are busting my chops that I don't spend enough time doing the projects and builds and stuff. If I spent more time in the office doing Kerbal, they'd really have words for me. Will this be compatible to Saturn? Artemis 1, it's a lot more powerful than Saturn 5. If they launch it as planned Monday morning, it'll be the most powerful rocket ever to lift off. And as far as thrust goes. It's going to be, more than the M1, more than the Saturn V. If SpaceX gets their Starship up, the full engine configuration Starship, not like the first one, but like the later one Starship. If they do get Starship working, it would definitely be more powerful than Artemis 1. Although after the next phase of Artemis is going to be more powerful still, because it's going to be more powerful second stage, and it's going to be a different rocket altogether. The phase two, next phase, Artemis. Would I volunteer for a ride on Artemis 1? No. No, I would not travel on Artemis 1. They wouldn't put a human on there anyway. Well, I guess I don't qualify. A lot of people wouldn't qualify me as being human, so yeah. But Fran on there, it's no big loss. But no, you nobody's clamoring to want to be on the first Artemis mission. No, it's uncrewed for a reason. is it even the second one? Because they're going to do this one, and then the next one they're going to do is going to be a moon flyby. It's going to be a deep space launch. They're going to do a moon flyby. It's not going to go into lunar orbit. And then I guess Artemis 3 is going to be crewed. And that I think Artemis 3, am I getting wrong? Is it going to be return trajectory? They're going to bring it back. It's going to be like a Apollo 8 kind of thing with the first crewed mission. But it's... There's no more, we're not racing the Russians to the moon, so that they don't have to throw all their eggs in one basket. They can afford to just, do a few missions without crews on them to find out if everything works first. Oh, Mr. Egg Cake, thank you. All right. Artemis 3 would be the moon landing. Now, I don't think they're not going to land on the moon. They don't have a lander. It's all orbital stuff, it's going to be a while. I'm not optimistic about the landing happening anytime soon, because they agreed to use the SpaceX for the landing, and so until SpaceX get their shit together, there's not going to be like a human landing. Boo sound. I like the super pair. Super pair. Cool. Reluctant Astronaut. Well, I put up the trailer to The Reluctant Astronaut last year. I don't know if it's still up there, but it was one of my early transfers, the trailer. It's classic FranLab shirt. It's one. This is one of them. This is one of the. Yeah, it's one of them. Oh, a love request. No request. No Zeppelin. Whew. What else we got? Oh yeah. Well, coming up in hour two. I went on a chocolate run. Got peanut butter cups. This is interesting. This is on the news again. But unless you're in Canada, or you probably didn't hear this, but. Here, come on, focus. Churchill portrait vanishes. The famed Ottawa Hotel. Yeah, the famous shot of the. Come on, focus. Come on, this camera. Oh, freaking A. Okay. But it's this portrait, not a painting. Like a 20x24 print, photographic print. Was hanging in the Ottawa in the hotel in Ottawa, yeah, the hotel, yeah, in the landmark hotel in Ottawa. Doesn't say which one. It's the Chateau Laurier. I can't pronounce French very well. Laurier. But yeah, so this had been hanging there since the 40s, and. People who worked at the hotel just kind of noticed it didn't quite look right. I think they said that the frame just kind of looked off, and we just kind of pointed out to some of the people at the hotel that it just didn't look right. And sure enough, turns out that it was not the photo that was supposed to be there, that someone had stolen the photo and frame and absconded with it and left a copy in its place. This is like a movie plot. But yeah, it says here that they think that backwinding, I guess, the possibilities. They thought that it probably was taken sometime between December 25th and January 6th. So yeah, over the long Christmas New Year's Eve week, someone did the switcheroo. Kind of like what was the movie? The Pierce Brosnan movie. That was about that. But I was wondering, it's not a painting; it's a photograph, which means that there's a negative. So why would someone go through the trouble of stealing a photograph? And why would it be such a big deal? Why don't they just print another copy and hang it? Well, it turns out that the photographer Josef Karsh had a very specific rule about these photographs, that there was only like one print of this made, and in 1992 his negatives were given to the Library and Archives Canada. No copies were allowed, and so the only prints in existence were those made originally by himself before 1992. So somebody wanted it, the picture of Churchill, and art thieves made a copy, swapped it out like over the holiday, like some 8 months ago. There you go. So some, which leads me to think, who the hell would pay art thieves? Like, somebody is sitting in some mansion somewhere in the world with a picture of Winston Churchill on their wall. Like, who would even, like, why? why Winston Churchill? That's just a weird thing to get a boner about. Winston Churchill. It's definitely weird news. I mean, obviously, you know, in Canada, in the Canadian archives, they have the negative. They can print another original copy and just replace it. And it'll be like it'll be the second existing copy. But Thomas Crown Affair. Thank you. Thomas Crown Affair. Not the Steve McQueen version, where he's a bank robber, but the Pierce Brosnan version, where he's an art thief, and a financier or something. It looks like a very old big baby. Yeah, well, that was the famous picture. The other one, this was in America. Chester Upland. This was a weird story. Hackers steal $13 million from Chester Upland. This is a school district. I don't have the front page because it says exactly where this was in the first page. Systems, Chester Upland. Oh, Delaware, yeah, the Delaware County. So it's local. Oh, wow, Delaware County, Jesus. So this is a local school district got hacked for $13 million. How they did this, though, is the real story. They said that the hackers are, if they're from international hackers, they say, and I hope this isn't like a quip, it says, the hackers with ties to Nigeria compromised the school district email system. Really? With ties to Nigeria? Is that a gag that the hackers got in using the Nigerian prince, the oldest of all bilking schemes on the internet, the Nigerian prince? Did they use the Nigerian prince to get in? But anyway, they gained access to the system through an account of somebody who worked in the system. That's not surprising. That happens all the time. But how they got their money is very surprising, because not only, if they're from a foreign country, not only did they know how to get into the system, but they had to know enough about the Chester school system to be able to convince the state comptroller through that account to send the funds for the school district to a new account. And they did it. So, I mean, that's like another level. I mean, it isn't enough just to hack the account, but they actually got in there using the authority of this hacked account to convince the state comptroller to change the way that they paid the school district and move it to this other account. But that was only half the scheme, because in order for them to get the money out of the country, they had to convert it into cryptocurrency. So then they had to bilk a woman in Florida who was a recent widower, and they cyber seduced this widower woman in Florida through a fake eHarmony account to get her to be a money mule, and they convinced this terribly aggrieved woman to be a money mule to move $13 million out of that account into cryptocurrency, which they, and by the time they got the $13 million out, the feds had got onto it, shut the whole thing down. But my God, it's like so many levels. It's like, man, that's like some really, really like other level stuff. So, man, hey Ziggy, thank you. The Morocco lemons, that's great. But man, I that really got me thinking about, man, how sophisticated did I have to be? Because that's like an Ocean's enter number here, Ocean's 11, Ocean's 9, Ocean's 8, Ocean's 12, whichever, you know, decade of Ocean's movies that you want to use. That's like that kind of level of grift. It wasn't enough that they just hacked into the account, but they had to commit so many people and be so on the money, literally, to get all this stuff, to move that money, to get the state comptroller in on it, and then to bilk like a woman in Florida actually to get the money into cryptocurrency so that they could actually pocket it. I mean, that's, man, that is some really next level stuff. Well, I'm sure that, you know, heads are going to roll in Chester about that. I wouldn't be surprised if it comes down to the idea that somebody working there was still running Windows XP and had like some free version of McAfee or something on there, or something like that, you know, the leaky faucets, you know. It's like, man, oh man. But that story, I'm sure there's going to be more news about that later on. That's a significant amount of money. Yeah, that was something. Also, this goes back to, I talked about this before, but I'm not going to talk again, but it says here that the CIA, thank you, begins compensating officers for Havana Syndrome injuries. Oh, BRM bug, thank you. I talked about Havana Syndrome before. A lot of people are saying, oh, Fran, that's conspiracy stuff and everything. Well, no, I mean, I've been reading about it for the better part of a decade, and there's a lot to it. It's not just hearsay. There have been brain scans done and everything. People are like permanently injured, and the symptoms people described specifically, people who suffer brain injuries, it really is indicative of some kind of microwave weapon, which is very interesting that, you know, the CIA should be interested if there's even a possibility of people being attacked with a microwave weapon, that they should be like having resources to gather information. And I'm sure that they have. It's just that it's all cloak and dagger stuff. So the CIA refuses to talk about it, but there's no way that they wouldn't be having monitoring equipment and stuff. It's just, it's one of those things that even if they did know it was happening, there's nothing they could do about it. So, you know, denial would be the cheaper way to go than to say, oh yeah, sure, it's happening, there's nothing we can do about it. It's like, goes back to the whole UAP thing, you know, much easier just to say that it's crazy talk, crazy people talking crazy talk, because there's nothing we can do about it, you know. But even though people are saying it's a conspiracy thing, the CIA is paying out people who got damages for, you know, getting brain damage, for getting their brain matter fried while on duty overseas. So to be continued on that. WinXP is running on a lot of critical machines. Yes, it is. I talked about that before, about especially in industry. XP was such a workhorse in so many industries, and it will be for decades to come. I mean, people talk about how COBOL is still being used on some systems, you know, for like different kinds of like data. Well, XP, it was used in so many as a platform for so many industrial systems, CNC machines. So when I did that tour of the circuit board factory years ago, when I was making Frantone pedals, and I showed the equipment working and the testers and everything. It was all that shit was running on XP. Their CNC machines were all running XP. The PC board cutter machine was running XP. And you know, you're not gonna just throw away a room full of CNC machines because Windows 10 is up. It's like, no, it's like these machines are built around the operating system. You know, you're not going to throw away the machinery. So yeah, it's like, got to keep these machines running. You know, I've got two XP machines in the other room that I use just because they're, there's lots of software that'll really only run on XP. And it's like, yeah, let's get the virtual machine and everything. Well, it's on my list, but you know, to really run a virtual machine, I really have to have a really good machine to run it on, because it is kind of a clock hog to do that, more than you would think. So, but yeah, it's on my list to just upgrade to a modern supercomputer, run a virtual machine, and convert all my old XP drives. Basically, I'd run my old XP drives off of a virtual machine and blah, 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 to run those old applications. It's in the works, but I don't have the time to do it this year. It's up for next year. but yeah, running offline, of course. Running offline. Windows, CNC machine with Windows ME. Wow. I don't envy that. Windows ME. Yeah. Yeah, there were some. Yeah. Windows 95. Windows ME. Oh. Yeah, there were some. Yeah. There were some not so good attempts between Windows 3.1.1 and XP. Like the weird gray area. Any updates on the custom cassettes? custom cassettes, my custom cassettes. My project, custom cassette? You mean my digital cassettes? The digital things? Or maybe you're confusing me with Techmoan. We're coming up on hour two, so let me pause for a moment. Everyone stay in a holding pattern. I'm gonna pause and come back in just a minute. Hang on. Time. Chew them if you got them. Oh. Increase my blood pressure doing that. Oh, yeah, before I eat this, I gotta eat this fortune cookie. I occasionally post on the social media part, the community page, like fortune cookie messages I got. This one I got today. I got two fortune cookies in my dinner, and this was one of them. I mean, this is definitely the weirdest fortune I've ever gotten, a fortune cookie. Let's see if I can. Question: what is KMS? Answer: keep mouth shut, the golden rule. Wow, really? Yeah, that is so snarky. Oh man, that is one snarky cookie. Keep mouth shut. Oh, a little further here. So yeah, this is another one. This is these come from Golden Wan. Yeah, these are from Wonton Food, which is up in Brooklyn. Golden Bowl from Brooklyn. When I had the Franton factory up there, I was down the street from the Wonton factory. I used to walk by there and smell the particularly when they made the chocolate versions, the chocolate fortune cookies. Whole neighborhood would smell like it. Oh. Oh. Hmm. Wow. These fortunes are getting really weird. What does this mean? Come on. A fine is a tax for doing wrong. A tax is a fine for doing what the hell? All these pop-ups for doing well. A fine is a tax for doing wrong. A tax is a fine for doing well. Oh, okay. Well, maybe. Wonton Company's getting weird. Getting weird. Okay. We're officially in hour two. So. Cam makes kind of a weird theremin. Aluminum can theremin. All right. So, it's hour two, so in keeping with tradition, hour two is kind of a free-for-all. If you wanna, okay, Film Thread Edition. I should show you a movie. Hang on. Patrons already have seen these on Patreon, so if you're not a patron, one of the perks of supporting FranLab on Patreon is you get the sneak previews of everything. I had some cool movies that I transferred this week. One of them is about television. I want to play this one. It's a short film. I'll turn off the lights. If you need to go to the bathroom, do it now. Take the hall pass. And no kicking around during the movie. But this will be up on the channel later this week. But I'll give you a sneak peek right now. Let's turn off the lights. Here we go.
Television. Much of our future depends on the way we use this medium of communication, for its influence on thinking and action is tremendous. Suppose we were privileged to enter the inner sanctum of a television station. Sit the men who, at the touch of a button, control the picture going to our home. Select from a variety of programs. News stories. Entertainment. Education. Sports. And advertising. For in a few short years, television has become one of the greatest merchandising media. How is all this done? What causes this almost instantaneous transmission of sight and sound? It is an electron beam which paints the picture on your receiver tube. You can see the mark of this beam when you turn your receiver off. Let's look at one of these receiver tubes and find out how television works. This is known as a cathode ray tube, because under high voltage electricity, the cathode gives off a beam or ray of electrons. You might call this an electron gun, which shoots a stream of tiny negative particles at the face of the tube. The fluorescent coating on the face glows where the electron beam strikes it. Now, let's look into a TV camera. Through one of its lenses, an image is formed, not on film, but on another tube. A tube which costs more than $1,000. This type is called the image orthicon tube. In it is another electron gun, which sends out a steady stream of electrons. Now, this target is made so as to pick up a series of electrical charges. When the lens forms an image on the sensitive plate, and these charges vary the magnitude of the returning electron beam. To understand this, let's imagine that we want to televise a single dot, not a white dot, not a black dot, but something in between. In the camera tube, the lens forms an image of the dot on the plate, setting up a charge on the target. According to the brightness of the image, the electron beam is changed when it returns from the target. This changed beam is amplified and sent out by the tube. In the television transmitter, this picture signal is amplified and combined with a very high frequency carrier wave. The carrier wave, with the fluctuation caused by the image of the gray dot, goes to the transmitter antenna and is radiated from the top of the tower. The receiver antenna picks up the wave and sends it down the lead-in wires to the receiver. Here, the signal controls the electron beam so that it strikes the fluorescent face just hard enough to make a gray dot on the receiver screen. Thus, the basis of television is an image of light, which controls electricity, which regulates transmitter waves, which again control electricity, and finally is turned back into light. But television is more than a gray dot. It's a whole picture. And it moves. To understand how television makes pictures that move, think of this. When you read a book, you don't read the whole page at once. You read a little bit at a time, swinging your eye across line after line. In the TV camera tube, the beam of electrons can do much the same. Electrons are affected by magnetic fields of deflecting coils. These coils make the electron beam sweep back and forth across the target. These coils make the beam swing up and down. Together, they swing the beam across one line, then back to cross another lower down, and still another lower. Thus, in effect, the beam looks at each point of the picture, and it varies according to the brightness of each point. The movement of the beam in the camera is accurately timed in the TV transmitter by a sync generator, which generates synchronizing pulses. These pulses are also sent out over the air as part of the video signal. In your receiver, these pulses synchronize the sweep of the electron beam to the station being received. And as the beam sweeps back and forth, line after line, the strength of the beam keeps changing, modulated by the video signal. Where the beam is strong, the tube glows brightly. Where it's weak, the tube remains dark. Thus, the camera and the receivers watching it are electronically linked together. And the signal from each point in the camera tube is transmitted and turned into a picture of the same point on the receiver tube. So, on your receiver tube, pictures are painted by an invisible beam, darting back and forth at speeds thousands of miles per hour. In the most common forms of television, the beam scans every other line, then goes back to fill in. This is called interlace scanning. With 60 interlaced pictures per second, or 30 full pictures per second, it assures a steady image with no flicker. And because your eye has a persistence of vision, this series of pictures gives the illusion of motion. Add sound through FM radio, and you have television. In today's airwaves, television occupies the very high and ultra-high frequencies. These waves cannot normally be received beyond the horizon. So the area of TV reception is limited. Television transmitters are linked, sometimes by coaxial cable, a special wire-in-tube arrangement to carry TV signals, and sometimes by relay stations. Located usually on high ground, they receive a signal through one of the horn-shaped antennas, boost it stronger, and transmit it on to the next station. Thus, television is sent from coast to coast. Images picked up by cameras and turned into radio wave signals which tell a fleeting, invisible beam how to paint moving pictures in your home. Wouldn't you like to know more about television? The cameras, the lights, the production techniques? For those who understand television, there are many vocational opportunities. Let this be only the beginning of your study of television.
Hello? Ah. Ah. Well, I turned the knob up. Oh, crapola. Is everything I've been saying for the last couple minutes? Okay. All right, so what I said was that, it recorded on the, it'll be on the, okay. That film's from 1952, and, as I said, during the muted section, it's the kind of film that would have been shown in theaters before a feature. Like on a Saturday matinee, like on the weekend matinee, where they'd show serials and, you know, Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon, stuff like that. They would show a short film like that, like mixed in with other stuff, the kind of educational, like, film reel, along with newsreels and stuff like that. But yeah, I thought that was pretty sophisticated for 1952. And broadcast television in the United States was very new. I mean, it was stalled off for the war, so, you know, it was really only like 5 years of like real actual like broadcasting in the U.S. So yeah, very very early example of television in the U.S. So, oh, am I too loud now? I'm back on now. Okay. All right, I am back on now? Yeah, okay. Oh, okay, so yeah, I got about halfway through my bag of peanut butter cups during the film. I was doing what you do, watching the movie. I was just eating candy. if you got snacks, eat them. I'm reading the chat. If you got any questions, it's hour two, so I'll show another movie if you want. Do you want to see another movie? Or do you want to talk about something? Movie? Chat. Movie? Chat. Movie? Chat. Movie chat. In fact, I don't even have that movie in there. Come on. I got another movie here. What's the red box by the scope? It's a Star Trek com panel. Used to have this on every week. I played with it last week. Looking for the chat. No one's got any questions. I've got another cool film that's going to come up this week, which I can show you. Sneak preview. People on Patreon have already seen it. So think about your questions. We'll watch another short film. This one is from 1974, and it's very typical of the kinds of films that I would have seen like in my high school years, because this one is about careers. This is a film that would have been made to be shown to high school kids who are considering what they're going to do after they graduate. And this film was made to convince some of them that they should go into manufacturing and work in factories. But it's absolutely chock full of really amazing footage of all kinds of factories. They show prototyping like dream cars at Ford Motor and the Mustang assembly line making 1974 Mustangs. the modular synthesizers, they go to Quasar, showing manufacturing televisions that were still being made with tubes in 1974. There's mill machines, CNC mill machines that are running on a PDP-11. You can see the little tape things running in the background. All kinds, it's just absolutely chock full of stuff. I think they have rotary phones at GTE and lots of other things. No safety gear. No, you know, it's just the total, you know, Wild West days of, you know, take your health with you to the job. It's a short film. It's like 12 minutes or something, or 15. So think about your questions. And after we show the film and turn the lights back on, and I'll make sure that the the audio is on, hold your questions, give them to me after the film runs. And there is some delay between what I'm saying and what you're hearing. So go to the film, and we'll talk when the lights come back on. Yes, the music is removed for copyright. There's going to be some silent parts. I can't get around this, but you just have to be patient. I'll do theremin during this part.
Manufacturing is the process of creating products from raw materials. Our society depends on manufacturing, both for the products we use and for millions of jobs for millions of Americans. These elements of manufacturing, jobs and products, are tied together in the system we call supply and demand. People like you and me work at jobs where we can afford to buy products. When we buy those products, our money makes more jobs available for people like you and me. Look around. Put out your hand. Most of the things you can see or touch right now were made by the people who work in the world of manufacturing. The manufacturing process starts in somebody's mind. The idea that there is a need or a market for a certain product. Perhaps it will be a new invention. But more likely these days, the new product will be a refinement or a combination of existing products and ideas. You don't need a diploma to have an idea, nor are there special requirements for being an inventor. And indeed, many people have turned ideas into careers. Today, however, most new products are the end result of advanced technology, and most modern-day inventors work in corporate departments, known as R&D, research and development. Engineers, often working with business and marketing experts, conceive and develop most new products. These people usually have college degrees. It is then up to technically trained workers, electronics experts, assistant chemists, commercial artists, and so on, to build models and prototypes for finding out whether the idea is feasible, whether it will work. In consultation with the engineers, these people solve technical problems and discover the most efficient least expensive design. Likely, if you prepare for this sort of technical job, you will find a high-paying, secure career. College and technically trained product testers then go to work, making sure the product will do what is expected of it. Later, after a decision has been made to produce and sell the item, these people will test samples of the finished product to ensure customer satisfaction. The product, having been designed, is now up to other engineering specialists to develop a production method. Which parts will have to be made first? Which will have to be purchased from other companies? These engineers, consulting with plant managers, foremen, and representatives of other companies, must answer such questions. They are also involved in the purchase of new machinery and the physical design of factories. Production begins. There are two kinds of manufacturing. In the first, called capital goods manufacturing, businesses produce tools and machinery to be used by other businesses. The production of bulldozers and computers, boilers and lathes, fall into the category of capital goods manufacture. And it is here, usually, that basic raw materials are shaped into parts that later will become a finished product. People do the shaping. The average worker in most capital goods industries is highly skilled, with a trade learned either on the job or in a vocational school program. He is usually well paid. In these industries, you could find a career as a tool and die maker, who builds machines, a millwright, who installs them, a machinist, who uses them, or you could be a boiler maker, sheet metal worker, crane operator, or electrician. Once the parts and machines are made, they begin to arrive at factories engaging in the second kind of manufacturing, called consumer goods production. These are the industries that make products for sale to the general public. Autos, aspirin, toasters, toothpaste, the things we use in our daily lives come from consumer goods manufacturers. Historically, the first consumer goods manufacturers were craftsmen, and to some extent, that tradition lives on. Some special items still are produced by craft, making it possible occasionally for a young career seeker to find an apprenticeship in such trades as violin making, or glass blowing, cabinet making, or tailoring. But by far, most jobs in today's consumer goods manufacturing industries are for workers on the assembly lines. Let's take a look at the people, the jobs, and what happens in the creation of one kind of product as an example of the hundreds of career opportunities in the manufacturing world.
Thank you.
advanced assemblers and operators who manufacture consumer goods have productive skills, which they have learned on the job. You can often begin a career in these fields with little or no education or experience. The wages can potentially provide a comfortable living, since the pay is steady and dependable, and the higher paying positions such as inspectors, supervisors, and plant managers often go to people who have experience in assembly line jobs. There is this to consider, however. The work is repetitious, demanding patience and concentration. You'll work indoors, and you'll probably have to live in an urban center, although some small industrial plants have been moving to rural areas. At some companies, staggered shifts may assign you unusual working hours, and there is always the chance of fluctuating employment prospects due to changing economic conditions and to automation. On the other hand, you should know that in response to worker dissatisfaction, some companies have been investigating job enrichment programs designed to make assembly line work more enjoyable. Manufacturing industries offer many additional opportunities to skilled support workers. Draftsmen are needed to draw blueprints. Technical writers are needed to produce instruction manuals, which accompany the finished products. And maintenance men, such as electricians, brick masons, and pipe fitters, are needed to keep the machines, furnaces, kilns, and boilers operating. Work with metals and glass, plastics and fibers, semiconductors and wood. Apply heat and pressure and leverage and torque, and you'll turn out goods for the marketplace. This is the manufacturing process. If you like to work with your hands, have some mechanical ability, enjoy fitting the pieces together, take great pride in what you do, even if you're making only one part of a larger product, and are dependable, then perhaps a career in the manufacturing occupations is for you. Your counselors can give you good advice on what courses to take. Talk to company representatives who often know of on-the-job training programs and to your state employment office. Each can help you determine the best way to go about preparing for and finding your first manufacturing job. The world of manufacturing, the people who shape the raw materials into the millions of products we use every day. If you can see yourself doing this kind of work, then perhaps a satisfying career awaits you in the world of people and things.
Back. Lights are back on. Yeah, that was interesting. It's made in Philadelphia. Oh, this is, yeah, this, okay. This is what it looked like.
There is this to consider.
That's what the original
however,
film looks like.
The work is repetitious, demanding patience and concentration. You'll work indoors. And you'll probably have to live in an urban center, although some small industrial plants have been moving to rural areas. At some companies, staggered shifts may assign you unusual working hours, and there is always the chance of fluctuating employment prospects due to changing economic conditions and to automation.
Even though it looks like this.
On the other hand, you should know that in response to worker dissatisfaction, some companies have been investigating job enrichment programs designed to make assembly line work more enjoyable.
As you'll see with the correction.
There is this to consider, however.
All that was there.
The work is repetitious, demanding patience and concentration. You'll work indoors, and you'll probably have to live in an urban center, although some small industrial plants have been moving.
Yep. There you go. That'll be up this week. On Patreon, there's some comments about, oh yeah, you know, the good old days before OSHA and before, you know, yeah, all this other stuff. Well, the reality was very different. I mean, when I was younger, I used to, back when I was in my 20s, I was freelancing as a videographer, and I worked with some other local videographers who did industrial films. And so I was, you know, in the 90s, I was going to factories, Alcoa and some of these others, you know, there were huge plants, and do training films, you know, like they'd make a video about how to work this press, you know, so that they can, when people come in, they can orientate them by, you know, showing them how to use the different kinds of equipment and stuff like that. And I used to work as a grip, you know, doing these things at haul equipment, set up stuff, set up the cameras, tear them down, stuff. But when I would go into these facilities, I'd be meet with managers. Managers would take us to supervisors, and supervisors would, you know, be around. And then, you know, so I got to meet all the hierarchies. And the one thing that I noticed right off the bat, whenever I went into any of these big factories, is that everyone in management was missing fingers and limbs. You know, it would be like, hi, how you doing? Yeah, you know, or hey, yeah, how you doing? You know, shake my hand. You know, like maybe one or two fingers left, or all these fingers are gone, or the thumb, the four fingers gone, and just these left. And it was like everyone in management had missing fingers or missing hand or, you know, missing limb. It was like that's how you got into management, by, well, you can't work the machine anymore, because it's like getting caught in the machine was almost like a promotion. So everyone in management was missing limbs. And so, I watched this film. It's like women running these huge industrial lathes, their hair's not back, it's just their hair's down. people assembling phones, you see a woman, she's spraying and wiping with a rag. It's like, yeah, all day, 40 hours a week, you're spraying, you know, carbon tetrachloride and wiping down with a rag, no gloves, no respirators or anything. You're spraying and breathing, you know, extremely volatile, very toxic chemicals every day. And those work environments were full of debris. I mean, lead, all kinds of volatile compounds. Those places would reek. You would go into them and all you'd smell is the chemistry. You know, like it would hit you when you get through the door, it would hit you in the face like a mattress. And then it's like after an hour, you get used to it. You don't smell the mech and the methyl ketone and the toluene anymore. I used to work at one place where they had these open vats, like 55-gallon steel drums, on top of these gas-powered, you know, burners. So 55-gallon drum of chemicals being heated with like a huge like flame burner to like boil it. And they, you know, they have like these huge like trees of parts that they bring up on ropes and drop down into these vats of chemicals, all in the open. No one's wearing masks, no ventilation. It's just, you know, that is the reality of manufacturing back in those days. And, you know, and people complain today about OSHA and all these regulations and stuff. Well, the reality was that factory work like that was not only extremely dangerous, but everyone got sick. And the truth was that if you got into those jobs, usually right out of high school, or you dropped out of high school to go right into work right away, you were working in that environment at a very early age, in your teens. By the time you got in your 20s, 30s, even your 40s, you'd be very sick. People ran into serious health problems in their 30s, 40s. A lot of them would get sick and die in their 40s, 50s. The idea of retiring from manufacturing was sort of a misnomer, because a lot of people just got too sick even to continue to work. And then there was no retirement, there was no benefits. You know, you didn't get like sick benefits for getting sick on the job. You just basically just couldn't work anymore, and you spend, you know, the last 30 years of your life debilitated and unable to work. And others just, you know, that they died young, or they died on the job, or died from being ill from exposure. And it never ever got to retire, you know. So back in those days, very, very few people, especially working class people working in factories, very few of those people actually got to retirement. You know, the 40s and 50s of those people, they most of them got sick and couldn't work anymore, or couldn't actually work long enough, or they got sick before they could even get their pension. That's why all these laws were created. That's why all these regulations were created, because of the unknown hundreds of thousands of people who lost their health and their lives to extremely toxic work environments. Unknown numbers of people. But all these laws and everything people complain about today, they exist because of all the people who died from occupational exposure to extremely toxic chemicals in very unsafe work environments, where companies just didn't give a crap about how it affected people. And they made people do insane jobs that no one today would even want to do. You know, to work with chemicals that no one today would ever want to be near. The environments of those places were just, they were indescribable in today's terms. Now, of course, they have a lot of those conditions over in Asia now, where a lot of things are done, but even there, it's not as bad. You know, as bad as it is like in Chinese factories, people complain about the, you know, child labor and stuff like that. But even in those areas, the Chinese know about all of the issues that we had in American factories. It was far, 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 far more severe than that. But yeah, I was in those places at the tail end, you know, when things were changing, but not quite. So I did have some firsthand of the realities of that stuff. But man, back in those days, in the early 70s, working in a factory, it was you did not leave a job like that with the health that you went in with, by any stretch of imagination. Yeah. Trichloroethylene, carbon tetrachloride was the other one. That was the, oh man. People today don't even know what working with chemistry like that was like, but those kinds of volatiles, I mean, carbon tetrachloride, you'd take a vat of that, you take a circuit board, you know, whoosh it, you know, drop it in, you know, a vat of carbon tetrachloride, swish it around a little bit, pull it out, it would be like shiny, like a brand new coin, and it would be dry like in 2 seconds. You just shake it off, boom, it's dry. There's like, it's gone. That kind of volatility, that's what made those chemicals so amazing. They would dissolve anything and they evaporated instantly. But you would be saturated to your chromosomes with the stuff at the end of every day. It's like the penetration of those chemicals going right down to the chromosomes, man. It's just, oh. And I had my share of, you know, all those banned chemicals in my early years, you know. A lot of them I swam in. I know that some of the things that you know, weighed me are because of my, you know, chemical exposure when I was younger. But for those people who worked at it every day, like every single frickin' day, and smoked on top of it. Yeah, they're not around now. You're not gonna find 80-year-olds who spent 40 years working in a machine shop like that. It's like, no, it's, no. Yeah. All right, I was off on another little thing there. Yeah, Silkwood. Yeah, if you want to get an idea of what it was like to work in industry back then, just watch the film Silkwood, you know, or the China Syndrome, you know, that's what it was like. It's really not a joke, you know. Everyone who complains today about the regulations and government overstepping and all these regulations that make it impossible to do business, all those people, they never worked in those factories, and they never had family who worked in those factories. Because people who worked in those conditions are the ones who fought for those laws. Yeah. And all the people are screaming, oh, we got to get rid of these pesky regulations and all these banned chemicals that we really need to use and everything. Well, yeah, all that is just stupidity. It's this is the thing that I said last week, my big, you know, rant last week about how people want to ignore history. There's a whole ignoring of history. And my saying that got me all this derision, like in the comments when I reposted it this week, about people, yeah, exactly, you know, people trying to change history and change how we teach history and make this new kind of fake history. No, it's like, dude, you're missing the point, you know? If ignorance of history has many levels to it, and the biggest ignorance of history is choosing not to know history that actually happened, but it conflicts with your sense of your own culture. Yeah. One of the most important books that I ever read was The Fire Next Time by James Baldwin. And I don't think anyone coming from my upbringing in my culture could read that book and not be changed by it. And it totally changed, you know, how I looked at myself and my own culture. And that's not revisionist history. That's actually learning more history. You can read David McCullough and James Baldwin, and you should read both, because it's not that one is telling a different story than the other. They're both telling the same story. And with these industrial films, it's like, yeah, people just want to ignore that history happened, that those laws exist because we needed them, that those protections of American workers exist because we had to do it, because companies were using humans as the oil to oil the wheels of their own industry, you know? It was like in that film Metropolis, the Fritz Lang film, where Moloch appears to Fred or Frederson, and he sees this hallucination of this machine that all these people are running as being this hungry god, and the people who are working the big machine are now like going up into this open mouth, and they're feeding the machine, like the bodies of the workers is going into this big furnace, and that's really what it was, you know. And it really pisses me off whenever I see a politician claiming like some high ground, saying that we got to reverse all these regulations that are making it impossible for us to compete. Well, no, it's like, dude, you want to go back to the good old days when we used to oil the machinery of our industry with the bodies of the workers? Like, yeah, it's like, man, yeah, there's reasons why we put those laws in place. The problem wasn't the regulations. The problem was that American consumers refused to pay higher prices for American products that were built safely, where American workers were protected and well paid. We wanted the products to be made in somewhere else where they didn't have any of that regulation, where people would be sacrificed for the lubrication of the gears of their own industry, and we ate up the cheap products, you know. Metropolis? It's like one of the most important films ever made. And lucky for you, if you've never seen Metropolis, in the last 20 years, there have been several releases of, there's the most recent one from several like efforts to recreate Metropolis. Because when I was younger, the complete film didn't exist. And there was the Giorgio Moroder version that I was familiar with in the 80s, which was like the best like reconstructed version that was available. But since, film archivists have discovered, you know, pieces of prints in different countries. I think there was one in Argentina or something that was discovered in recent years. And so there have been new restorations that have been done from like prints that have been found and pieces here and there. It's been reconstructed pretty well. There's like a Blu-rays that are out now that of the more recent, with the original scores, you know, with the original score done and everything. It's like completely reproduced. Highly recommended if you've never seen Metropolis. It's one of the most important films ever made. Yeah, I've been franting again. Well, it's the second hour. It's like I've been drinking all this caffeinated water and I'm all cranked up. So, yes, it's like the end of the hour two. I really go off on a tangent. But, you know, last week's rant, the reposting of it, so many people, it's like just proving my point by, you know, they say, oh, Fran, you're preaching to the converted, I'm with you, you know, it's the problem with all these trans people and all these gays and stuff trying to ruin everything. It's like, oh, dude, it's like, you're gonna say that you agree with everything I said and then take that 90 degree turn and you don't even know who you're talking to? But yes, so many, it's like, yeah, it's like, people only read in what they want to see. And so even though I was very careful and like went on like a 20-minute rant, was very specific about everything I said, people were just culling out like pieces of it that like it'd be like yeah, free speech, blah 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 blah, yeah, rights, blah blah blah. It's like they'd hear like the words that they wanted to hear, and then they just wrote their own narrative on top of it and said, yeah, you're with us. It's like, dude, you're not even listening to what I'm saying. But yeah, yeah. Fritz Lang, Metropolis. We're talking about Metropolis. Fritz Lang, the great filmmaker. Metropolis. But you know, there's lots of different versions of Metropolis out because, like I said, there were many different restorations, starting out with Giorgio Moroder's in the 80s, and then, you know, leading up into the aughts. But the more recent restorations are they keep refining it to get it like more and more close to like the original, which was, you know, for the original version, which was lost for half a century, more than half a century. Oh, did I watch the train wreck Woodstock 99? Yes, I did. That was very good. That was very good. I had seen other, you know, documentaries, like one-hour things about Woodstock 99, but that one, the three-parter, that just put such a fine point on it that it was just, oh, it was so brutal to watch, but so well done. Yes. Yeah, brutal. But yeah, that's worth watching. Train wreck. yeah, it's getting late. People are signing off. People are signing off. Five G, schmive G. Men in space? Yeah. Yeah, it's like we got some people hanging on here. The rock version. The rock version, that's Giorgio Moroder's. Great songs. I mean, Queen did some great songs, and Pat Benatar does a great thing. But I said, Giorgio Moroder's version was my introduction to Metropolis. But it's not that it's bad. It's just that it's like the best that could be done at the time. But that so many, like the more recent restorations are really complete with the original orchestral score and everything. You don't have to guess, oh, you know, what were the scenes, what would this scene have been like? It's like, yes, they've actually gotten pretty much the whole film back together again. But it took decades to find all the pieces. Zach asks, do I think that creative minds are essential for the progression of engineering of things? Well, yeah. You need people to dream up ideas. You'll find that the best, like, kinds of things come from the meeting of lots of different kinds of creativity. You have people like, you know, Buckminster Fuller, who are visionaries but who don't really do the science very well, and pretty much they like bullshit their way into conceptualism. Then you have people like Isaac Asimov, who is a genuine scientist who is also a dreamer, you know. When you have things where really creative dreamers can come together with really good crack engineers who can, you know, face the hard problems and say, well, you know, it's kind of against the laws of physics to do that, but, you know, we could do this. When you have different kinds of people who have different kinds of strengths that can come together on a project, then you can create really amazing things. That's where like the real impossible kind of dreamlike projects that we have come to depend on really come from. You know, places like Bell Labs, like these films that I show, some of them come from Bell Labs. Bell Labs was a place like that. That it was this because they employed not only like the physicists and the electrical engineers and chemists and such, but they also had like artists and painters, and it was a top-down paradigm with Bell Labs of like design, function, and form together. They employed all kinds of people to come up with like finished products. Places like that create magnificently wonderful things. Park was another thing. You know, the Xerox facility at Park was another place like that. Like for a shining window of time was just, it was like you go to Park in like 1973 and you were walking into the 1990s, like this brief, like those little technological Shangri-Las. Those kinds of places are, I don't know if they exist anymore because companies aren't like that anymore. There are very few companies that exist in, that, you know, pay a lot of money just for pure R&D. That is pure R&D, it's not really dedicated to the idea that the end product of this team is going to be a product. I really don't know of any companies that are just doing pure research and development for the sake of it anymore. Not like it was done in the old days where it was really like anything goes, like blank check, you know, dream and build. Because people could say, oh, Google and Valve and those places, they've got, you know, these big R&D departments. Yeah, but that's very, you know, those missions are very different because that's all centered on the idea that the end result of that R&D is that there's going to be products, very specific things. But that wasn't the case with Bell Labs necessarily or Park. It was a different time. But companies don't do that anymore. They won't throw endless resources just at people just to dream, you know. I wish they did. I really wish they did. If they did, I would work there. I'd want to work there. All right. End of hour two. I'm reading the chat because I was off talking there, looking for the discussion. Oh, Carlos, thank you. Carlos giving me a virtual cup of coffee, which I'm already maxed out my caffeine, but thanks for the virtual cup, Carlos. I appreciate that. I'm back one in the chat, seeing if I've missed anyone. No? Okay. Well, it is getting late, kids, and looks like we got some people hanging on because Clive isn't doing his thing, I guess, I don't know, I guess for the summer, so we're not going to get the Clive runoff, but like I said, barring some unforeseen event, Dave and I are going to do the dual webcast early Monday morning, Eastern Time, U.S., so providing that we can make it work and not, well, Dave's side's going to be fine. Providing that things don't get messed up on my end, we will be doing that live for Artemis 1 on Monday. Do you hear that? Hear the bike kids? Hear that? I don't know if you can hear it. Carrie, what? What did my first prototype cost? Way back. Well, it was a lot, but in 1994 dollars, it was a lot of money. It took me 10 years to pay it back when I took over the company from my business partner. It was a lot. But that was the other thing. Can kind of like talk about it, but you know, the in the discussion in American news is because this new thing is being passed. I don't know if it's not officially passed yet, but there's this debt relief thing, the idea of giving like $10,000 of debt relief to people, you know, for college, and a lot of uproar about that. I think that it It's not quite fair because I am pro small business and I'm pro entrepreneur. Thanks, Dave. I'll get back to Dave's question in a moment. But I, as someone who is, you know, an entrepreneur from my 20s, where, you know, if you're young and you decide rather than going into college and getting into debt doing that you go into making your own business and you get into debt doing that. And boy, I mean, the first 15, 20 years of manufacturing, I get into tons of debt that I have not even begun to pay off yet. I mean, I carry a lot of debt from Frantone that I'm going to be paying off for many, many years to come. Lots of debt hanging on from Frantone. I haven't made Frantone in a long time, but I'll be paying that debt back for freaking ever. So yeah, when you make a company, you know, if you're a young person and you can get deep into debt, making up your own business. And so I think, well, if you're going to have debt relief for people for college, for working class, you really, in all fairness, should offer debt relief for people who decide to be entrepreneurs and get into debt making up a business instead. That would be a fair balance of forces, you know, and conservatives would be on board with that. Although, very typically, I don't hear conservatives saying, oh, we need to have debt relief for businesses, because they're not even bringing that to the table. How about winning some points, Republicans? You know, bring it to the table. Okay, look, Democrats, we'll see your $10,000 of debt relief for student loans if you give $10,000 of debt relief for small businesses for young people who are starting up, you know, as debt relief. How, you know, throw that in the pot. But they're not doing that. Why? Well, because it's government overstepping everything. Well, you know, make it fair. But that's how you make it fair. Debt relief, okay, for college, also for entrepreneurs, for small business. That would make it fair. Not that it would put even a drop in my bucket. I would need like an order of magnitude more than that. But yeah, manufacturing, if you get into business, you get into major debt. Major debt. So, but that's being kicked around this week as well. But yeah, you will get into deep in debt doing manufacturing. The only winning move is not to play. Do not get into manufacturing. I get so many people, young people, like, oh, Fran, I want to have a pedal company. I have this new idea for a pedal. I want to make it. I want to make the pedal. I was like, well, go ahead and make the pedal, but don't make it for money. Because if you're going to get, if you're going to make another pedal company, you're just going to have yet another company that's going to be losing a lot of money. And you're going to be spending all your time and spending all your money making a product that will not get you profit in the end. It's like, the only winning move is not to play. oof, boy. But yeah, it's highly risky. Any of you that are thinking about, you know, starting up a business, you go into my, two lectures on entrepreneurship. One I did about pedals that I gave at Brown University. It was very specific to Frantone, but the other one that I did at UArts before that, they're both up on my channel. But the one at UArts was much more general about entrepreneurship and about how I have done, you know, my own companies and such. But very high risk. I said in those that, you know, the vast majority of startup businesses will fail in the first 5 years, the vast majority. And the vast majority of those failures will fail within the first like 6 to 12 months for just running out of money and being undercapitalized. So you have to have lots of things in place. If you're gonna start your own business and you do not have like a shitload of capital to start with, you're really, really putting a lot of your whole future at risk doing that, because you'll run into debt. The money will run out, you get deeper in debt, and before you know it, you're not even going to have a company running, and you've got nothing but debt, and the debt will kill the company, because you won't even be able to be profitable, because you need like crap loads of resources, not only to get started, you pretty much have to think about exactly how much it's going to cost for you to do everything for the first 5 years. That's rent, parts, people, healthcare, taxes, everything. Imagine every cost that you're going to have doing the business the first 5 years. Then double it, because you're going to underestimate it by at least 50%. Double that figure. That's the money you need to have up front to even start, because the first 5 years you're not going to make dime one. And so you have, that's how much resources you have to gather to do it. And it's case in point with every Kickstarter of somebody who comes out with a great product, they do a Kickstarter, they get millions of dollars, and then they have to deliver and they just can't deliver the product because they, not only did they drastically underestimate what it would cost them to do it and how much time it would take them to make it, but they didn't even think about what it would cost just to get the company made. So that's really the equation. You gotta really project your best estimate of, like, taking into consider every single component, all the shipping costs, all, you know, there's gonna be stuff that you're, until you get into the business, you're not even gonna know what the costs are, but everything that you could possibly imagine for the first 5 years, that round number, double it, and then that's the capital you need at the start just to get going. And you're gonna run through all that money, whatever that figure is, you're gonna run through that money within the first 5 years, maybe even sooner. And you might not even have a running company or a finished product to offer at that point, but you're gonna run through all that money just getting going. It's like the Saturn V or Artemis I, all the fuel in that fuel tank just to get to orbit, you know, and all the weight you have to shed. You know, that's the way you look at starting a business. Just to get off the launch pad, you have to have all that fuel, and you have to have all that power just to lift all that fuel off the ground. And then, you know, like the Saturn V, how many millions of pounds of fuel were shed just to get to the, just to clear the tower or whatever? That's what it's like starting a business. You have to have so much in the form of resources. If not, you're going to be deep in debt very quickly. I ought to know. And you might get very easily and very quickly into so much debt that there's no way that you could even pay the money back, even if your company is profitable. There are just so many ways to screw the pooch in business. And so yeah, that's really the rule. If you're gonna start a business, you really have to have the capital up front. And it's much more than you would estimate at the start. It's many times that is what it always ends up being. You know? Harsh realities. That was a long answer. Yep, that's the rules of the game. And we are over time, people. We are way over time. So I'm gonna put it to bed. And like I said, I'll be back Monday morning early with Dave Jones. We're gonna try that thing, barring some unforeseen event. Thanks everybody, and there'll be videos this week. There'll be some films, some other things. This thing on Monday's taking up all my time outside, so probably no projects this week. I'll have to put those off until after. But we'll be back here next Saturday doing the live stream again and all that stuff. So, all right. Thanks everybody. Dave's question, whether there's another question in here, don't forget Dave's question. I didn't see, did I miss a question? I'm backing up here, last chance. I'm not seeing a question. All right, well, save it for next week. Bring it up early next week, your question. And all right, we'll see you then.
Bob, all these big boulders around here that I've looked at are the same rock type. Ooh, who pulled over the geophone module? Can't imagine.
Fly DBA.
Go ahead.